welcome you to our annual Vespers program. I want to thank our students, our members of our community, our faculty and staff for sharing their enormous talents with us this evening. And on behalf of the Muskingum University community, I wish each of you a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Our call to worship is a responsive reading with the choir singing throughout. I will read the one, the congregation will read the many. Let us continue our worship. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light.
Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined.
Let all mortal flesh keep silence.
You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy.
It rejoiced before you as the joy of the harvest. As people exult when dividing plunder.
But with fear and trembling sound.
For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor you have broken as on the day of Midian.
For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments cold in blood shall be burned.
Given to us, authority rests upon his shoulders.
And he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Christ our God, so God, who is heavenly.
His authority shall grow continually. There shall be endless peace for the throne of David. And his kingdom.
He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore.
Also, all his truth divine.
Calls us out of darkness to proclaim the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together, they come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord.
Oh. salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live their lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly. While we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, he it is who gave himself for us that he might redeem us all from iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds.
Thank you. But the scripture has imprisoned all things under the power of sin, so that what was promised through faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Now before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Jesus Christ. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. My point is this: heirs, as long as they are minors, are no better than slaves, though they are the owners of all the property, but they remain under guardians and trustees until the date set by the Father. So with us, while we were minors, we were enslaved to the internal spirits of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God.
mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus.
Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them.
Into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, and he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
In a cross-legged crouch, the shepherds are hunched forward under the midnight drizzle. Too cold to sleep and too bored to imagine anything more than a dark sky. Shepherds listen for the howl of the wolf, and shepherds stare at sheep, which under the cover of night appear as mysterious, dull, woolly splotches of cream darkness that flow to the edge of the field and then shiver back into a huddle. it gets less mysterious because it goes on all night. Shepherding at night is a dark boredom. Shepherding on the cold slopes takes real endurance. The unruly sheep of the night are tended by shepherds with red eyes, sore backs, and bored minds. The predictable plot in the life of a shepherd each night is much like watching the grass grow, the paint dry, or hearing the clock tick. Every shepherd knows that the true light comes with the morning, when the light bleaches the horizon with a gradual smoldering hue. The light comes when the sun rises and the sheep just look rested and dirty. As the night shepherd stands, he stretches his back, cranes his neck with a tilt to the side, lets out a yawn, and then trudges on down the hill as the shepherds of the day pass him going up. This is what the light means to the night shepherd. The light means you're done with boredom. The light means you've made it. The light means you can see things for what they really are. For the shepherd of the night, the light means rest. It means warmth. It means everything, in fact. So here's how it went down. The true light came a tad earlier than the morning. The true light did not wait for the celestial constant. The horizon did not grow gradually milky and then beige and then warm to a pink and then fire to red before slowly peeking over the horizon with a white speck of light. It was different that night. Something changed. Something forever altered the night sky. The night sky spoke to the night shepherds. The vast cold darkness of the night was split wide, and that which was beyond came so very near. Dangerously direct in its arrival, catastrophically close in its disclosure, the night sky spoke to the night shepherds, and they were forever changed, altered with light, infused with a joyful purpose, overwhelmed with a desire to run, I mean to absolutely run, to the town of Bethlehem. So here, as best as I can figure it out, who showed up to crack the night sky with a blazing light and a booming voice? God split the night sky. And the shepherds of the night heard it, and they saw it. The rolling hillsides echoed a message, and the silent half of the earth we call night brightened with a word from God, a message so wondrous that hundreds would fall to their knees in a whisper of peace underneath a festival of stars in a matter of days. On that night, God told these night shepherds that a young Jewish girl would give birth to eternal love made mortal flesh. On that night, the night shepherds are told that there are two Bethlehem-bound pilgrims, and one of them is carrying a homeless God lost in the night. So here we sit, like aching shepherds of a dark boredom, biding our time, making our plans, waiting for the morning light, and it has already come. Under the sweet skies of the world, we look starward, the air thick with alleluias, for we can also be Bethlehem-bound, and we can also believe the gift of the Christ child. The light descends, and we realize that we are more than troubled guests on a dark earth. We are shepherds of the night, running down the hillside with a place to go and a reason to go, because the light shines in the darkness. And soon the whole world will kneel in thanks for a promise kept, new life. For in this nativity, we find our own. Amen. Spirit, comfort us in all darkness, and turn us always toward the light of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
I hope you will all join with me in thanking our participants for their extraordinary time and talents in bringing us this wonderful program. Thank you all.